Welcome back, everyone, to WIPO's Mission Imagination. Studies have shown that diverse teams with a wide array of perspectives lead to greater innovation and better solutions to complex problems, like climate change, food security, and others. But there are many people across the globe whose innate human ingenuity is not being effectively tapped for our collective benefit. Today, we will be talking about women and girls. By just one metric, our data on the global gender gap in patenting shows that women represent only 16% of all inventors. And we see a similar situation in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, the STEM fields, where women represent only 35% of all students enrolled in STEM-related higher education. Today, we have the honor to have as our guest, Ms. Aisha Bowe, a pioneering aerospace engineer, rocket scientist, and entrepreneur who is breaking barriers and paving the way for more women and underrepresented minorities in STEM. Aisha is a future real-life astronaut. She is confirmed to travel on a commercial flight to space with Blue Origin aboard the New Shepard launch vehicle. With a passion for innovation and social impact, Aisha founded STEMBoard, a tech company that empowers individuals and organizations to solve complex problems through STEM solutions. She is also a vocal advocate for gender diversity and inclusion in STEM fields, using her platform and expertise to address the systemic barriers and biases that limit opportunities for underrepresented groups. Aisha, welcome. It is great to have you with us today.
Thank you for having me.
Well, let me start with the very basics. What made you actually be interested in space?
I never thought that I was going to be interested in space. I actually began my academic career with really low grades. I graduated high school with a 2.3. For those of you who are familiar with that, it meant that I did not pass a lot of my classes in high school. And a lot of it was because of the environment that I was in. I wasn't able to choose who I was born to, and I certainly wasn't able to choose the environment that I was in at the time. And what I realized was that a lot of what I thought about what I could do was based off of these early failures. And so because my freshman and sophomore year, I did not succeed, I thought that I was not intelligent, and I thought that I couldn't, and that I shouldn't, and that I can't. It wasn't until I entered into community college, because I didn't even apply for college. That's how much I thought about myself and my intellect at that time in my life, that I stumbled into an algebra class. That's right, algebra. I had algebra in high school, and I didn't necessarily do well in that. And I found a teacher who had a love of math and science. She was a woman, she was an electrical engineer, and she was working at Ford Motor Company at the time. And she simply asked me to relax and not focus on the enormity of trying to pass a degree program, but just to think about the class and allow myself to learn and be interested in the topic. And that class, which I ended up getting an A in, turned into another A. And before you knew it, I was getting A's in calculus, and I ended up deciding that if I could find out that at 18 I had potential, I would promise myself that I would pursue that potential to the furthest. And I decided to study aerospace engineering because that would mean that I was right and that society and reality at the time were wrong, and that I could truly be whatever it was that I put my mind to being.
I love that message, Aisha. I think it's really this importance of having role models that really change our tracks is so true. What are the lessons you have learned from all these years as an entrepreneur?
I started STEMBoard because when I was working at NASA, I was so excited about the mission. I volunteered to go into classrooms to talk to students at universities, and I actually had a hard time talking about my work. And it wasn't because I was afraid, it was because I couldn't get to the subject. Students were so perplexed by my existence. You would have thought that I was the alien, because when I went into the classrooms, they were, how did you get here? There's no way that you could be in aerospace. Engineers don't look like you. And I remember saying to the students, well, I'm supposed to be here. Your teacher invited me in. I have a NASA badge. I promise you, I'm supposed to be talking to your class today. And then they would start to ask me more questions. Well, your parents must have been brilliant. You must have come from an affluent family. And when I mentioned that I was the byproduct of divorced parents, when I was born, my mom was cleaning houses and my father was driving a taxi. And neither of the two parents were necessarily, you know, determined to make me a STEM star, although they did want me to be happy and feel supported and successful in my life. And in those interactions, I started to realize that you cannot be what you cannot see. And for so many students around the world, they did not see women and people of color in these fields. And so they did not aspire to be within them themselves. And I could do something about that by deciding to take a leap, to leave my job, which at the time was very secure and my family was not a fan. They were a little concerned, and crowned my own company. And in founding that company, I decided that I wanted to do two things. I wanted to lead an organization that could be an example, a model to other people around the world that they themselves could be successful in the very same thing that I did. And two, I wanted the company to never forget where it came from by systematically investing and nurturing the emerging workforce. And what that meant was that for the last 10 years, STEMBoard has dedicated a portion of its revenue to going into the community and developing education and outreach programs, content and curricula for schools, nonprofits, and universities. And that effort has become so successful that we actually spun it into its own company, which is called Lingo. And we now create coding kits, which have been used by over 5,000 students in 10 countries.
That's amazing, Aisha. So when we talk about your advocacy work, what made you interested in, you know, doing this work in addition to your career, basically? What was the driver behind it?
I got tired of being the one woman or the one African-American woman. I wanted there to be a lot of women, and I wanted there to be voices from all around the world. I would have experiences that I felt I shouldn't have when I would go to conferences, when I would travel. I loved my job. I loved the agency that I worked for, but I didn't enjoy the views that some felt about women in technology and women in the workplace. I found that in many instances, these views that were so strongly held were out of date. And I thought the only way to sunset these opinions was to increase the number of people like you and I, who were decision makers, who were empowered to weigh in on what work would be like in the future.
So I have to talk about space. I have to ask you about Blue Origin. What does it mean to you to be part of this space flight?
I don't know if I have the word. It's a feeling that I can barely communicate, because I'm going to be the sixth African-American woman to go to space, the sixth in the history of space. And that means that I have the opportunity to carry on the legacy of four NASA astronauts, one of whom was the very first African-American woman to go to space, Mae Jemison, and also Dr. Proctor, who was the first to travel on a commercial space flight with SpaceX. I feel like we're entering in a time when space is truly for all. And if I, a girl who had no intention of ever entering this field or ever becoming a CEO, I mean, I'm running a multi-million dollar company without a business degree, without formal mentorship, a company that I started on my own without having wealthy family or investment, can one day become an astronaut? What is it that people think that they cannot do? And why is it that you think you cannot do it, right? I want people to challenge that. If I can do this, there should really be no limitations that others place on themselves and what they can do in their lives.
Okay, so let me ask about intellectual property. So why do you think it is important for girls, women, and minorities to turn to intellectual property to, you know, concretize their inventions and you know, have a better impact on their creations.
I absolutely love the question. I think that IP is a important and foundational element for all who are thinking about inventing or even have a great idea. I know for myself, intellectual property has allowed for me to take the hard work that I poured into both of my organizations and protect it. It's very easy to have an idea, but it's much harder to execute. And one of the things that we've done is we pursued trademarks, we pursued copyrights, the very same educational elements that we create and people know and love that are produced by my organization are protected from copyright infringement. They're protected from people who may want to take our ideas and use or represent them as their own, because we decided that we would pursue a partnership with not only intellectual property as the fencing around our ideas, but be informed by strategies that other organizations have taken to grow well-known and established brands. And so I'd like to extend an invitation for people who may not be familiar with this concept to do a little research online and learn how they themselves can use IP to protect the ideas that they create. Like for years, I created things and I did not protect them. And I didn't really realize the importance of that until we started doing business with organizations like Amazon. And I realized that unless we had a trademark, we couldn't actually own our brand. And without owning the brand, we could have other people copy and sell our products online. How scary is that? And with that protection, it allowed for me and the company to say, this is something that we created. It has value. It is not only an asset, but we own it. And you cannot imitate me on the internet and sell it to other people. And that's one of the things that IP does for you. It allows you to protect your goods as you go and you sell it in a global marketplace.
That's a very accurate message. And indeed, we really encourage the participation, the greater participation of women and girls in intellectual property. It was great talking to you, Aisha.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone, for joining us for this interesting discussion about how we can create a more equitable and inclusive STEM landscape that favors innovation, and why diversity is not just a buzzword, but a crucial ingredient for progress and success in the 21st century. Subscribe to our channel to get notifications of other interesting interviews, and leave any feedback in the comments below. Until next time.